you on the road.
You're listening to IBNX. IBNXradio.com.
Welcome to this week's edition of the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice, and my correspondent,
Chris Wyatt.
All right, so today is Boys' Day. It's the guys' day today because Morgan is out. She has a case of food poisoning, which I am finding is becoming more and more common. So does that mean that we are not checking the food we're preparing, or... I don't know what that means, but I just know it's becoming a lot more common. I'm not used to hearing that.
Stay prayed up before you go to
prayed
eat.
Up.
Well, apparently you pray up with your food because that's the problem with the problem.
Say your grace.
Say your grace.
And also in the studio today, we have today's guest, Mrs. Erica Wright from You First Incorporated.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Yay. Welcome, welcome, welcome. All right, so listen. She did not know that I have been watching her for a year. the work that she does, which I'm just going to give a tidbit because we're going to interview her the second hour, so I want to have that all fresh and let her tell you about it because it's amazing what her organization does. But this phenomenal woman has been traveling almost the world at this point. I'm going to speak it, traveling the world, just feeding the homeless. And the way she does it and the work they do is absolutely amazing. And like I said, for me to follow you for a year, that says a lot because I don't pay attention to very many people because I don't have time. But
when I saw
what you did and to see what you've done in a year, it's amazing. Awesome. And yeah, like I said, I'm not going to get into it because I'm going to let you tell it. But so she's sitting in today on our Hot Topics or the Gray Matter, as it's called. So we're going to jump right into the Gray Matter. And there are so many things going on in the world right now. But I think the one that's the biggest is definitely immigration. But I'm not going to do immigration out the gate because we did immigration last week. So we'll do immigration a little later. Outside of that, the biggest thing that I saw is, and I'm gonna do this one because apparently it was Pride Weekend in I think New York or something like that.
A little bit everywhere.
I know a little bit. I think New York was the biggest though. Yeah. I saw them in the streets and all kinds. I was like, okay, they're having a real party. So because of that, I'm gonna let the first topic be the case of the baker and the same-sex couple. So for those that are not familiar, in Colorado, a baker, Jack Phillips from Masterpiece Cake Shop, which is his bakery. Was asked by a same-sex couple to make them a wedding cake, and he refused because of his religious beliefs. He's a Christian, so he believes in a man and a woman is marriage, and same-sex is not does not carry the same weight, things of that magnitude. So he refuted them. They took him to court. I think this went on for about 6 years, and the Supreme Court, I think on June the 4th, actually sided with him and said that he had the right to refuse service based off his Christian beliefs. Well, apparently, over the weekend, they had more conversations about it, and they decided to send it back to the lower court to revisit. I'm not going to say that's a reversal, because that's not how it was worded. Because a reversal would imply that it was like, okay, we made a mistake, so we're going to overturn this, and you guys look at it again. They just said, hey, look at it again, and let's see what you come up with. So how do we feel about it? What are our thoughts? Chris, I'll let you start because Erica's even more. So I'll let you start.
Well, I don't have all of the opinion from how they made the decision. It's a real tough issue here because, you know, we're talking about rights, human rights, and then we're talking about the right to run your business. And so I don't, you know, I know things are done on state levels, and that's why this became a federal level thing, because it's just such a very tough issue on how to figure out how to serve everybody. And this, in this day and time, trying to be politically correct is so hard for everybody, because everybody's trying not to offend somebody, and then still define who they are at the same time, like, and be strong on what they think they, what they stand for.
Well, let me say this. It got complicated because the Colorado Civil Rights Commission got involved, and they felt like, you know, it's discrimination. So, like you said, you start getting into all these other variables. Like you said, the right for you to refuse service. It's his business.
Right.
He retains that right. But at the same token, does he have the right to discriminate against a classified group of people?
Exactly. Because I think unless you put on your, you know, it's advertised that this is a business that does just this, then you have to be available for all your business.
Well, I agree with
so,
that.
You know, now if you say this is a Hebrew store that we're doing things only kosher foods and this and that, and that's all we do here, and you, it's advertised that that's all we do here, and that's in your, the way that you set up your business, it's in your, you know, the description of your business, then I would say maybe they have something to stand on. But if you're available for business, because then we get into this discrimination like we had back when there's racial discrimination. I'm not going to serve you because of how I feel. Mm-hmm. You know, how, I have my own bias, so I don't want you eating here. I don't want you staying in this hotel. I want you to go through the back door. So I would say if you have a business and you describe this business and it's totally advertised that this is your how what you do within the scope of your business, and it's a legal thing that it's not going to be a discriminating thing, then I would say, you know, they could have something to stand on. But if they're doing something that they have to be open to business, then I would say that the business is wrong because they have to do what the customer is asking.
So let me add another
and not be trying to judge a person first and then decide, am I going to do business with you?
Well, let me add another variable. So apparently he's refused to do Halloween cakes because they also go against his Christian beliefs. So it's not like he said, okay, well, this particular thing I'm not doing. Anything that goes against his Christian belief, he's been inclined not to do. So he's refuted to do a Halloween
cake.
Well,
then guess what? Then is he only taking Christian money? Now, see, this is where it gets this is why we have a Supreme Court. This is why we have a court, you know, your Supreme Courts of your state. Because these are areas that go like beyond what two humans might be able to discuss and just come to a decision on. Because if we both stand firm on what we're talking about, on our rights, then we need a referee.
Well,
or judge.
All right, Erica, what you got? What you got?
Okay, come on now.
As a same gender loving person, I see it on both sides. I see it as a business who he has decided to run his business the way he see fit. I agree with you. Unless things are posted, what makes me not think that I would come in with my partner and say, hey, we would like to have a cake. Now, I would like to say, if I find out that this person has a problem with me and my partner, then I'm not going to buy a cake from him. So me being that justice fighter, I believe in fighting for your cause. I believe in speaking up for your rights. But I also believe that we have a choice to take our business where we see fit, where the emotions are going to come back to us in that capacity. And so, but yeah, I agree with you too. We need a referee, because on the other point of that is, if we don't speak up for ourselves,
yes,
these things continue to just blossom and blossom and mm-hmm. blossom. And it's not taking the right of a person who says, this is who I am and this is what I believe in, so I choose not to do this or do that. That's great. But at the end of the day, our rights or our voices have a platform as well.
Okay, so in the discussion, since we're here, with the, because when they were deciding to allow same-sex marriages, the argument came up, okay, well, why don't we let them have something, but they can't call it marriage, right, where they can call it a civil union or something like that. In the argument, do you think, and I'll ask you, do you think it's more of a, we want the word marriage, or is it more about we want the rights that come with marriage?
I would hope it's we want the rights that come with marriage.
So if they called it civil union, would that still be, would that be the same in your mind?
No.
So you'd want the word marriage?
I would want the word marriage. If that's something that I'm seeking, then of course I would want that title, marriage. But and I think even in society now, not just with the work that I do, I think we sometimes just kind of conform to what, just kind of go with the flow sometimes. And just because, okay, well, this is how it's been all of these years. This is what we've been doing. This is marriage. This is how it looks. And then when something different comes along, we don't even want to look at it. We're not going to take a second look at it. This is how it's been. This is how it's going to go. Oh, okay. So guess what? Okay, so if you're going to change it, this is what we'll give you. That's not fair.
Okay.
That's not, Chris, that's not
well,
fair.
Well, it's, you know, that's why this is something that I think the whole country's watching, and probably the world also, because everybody's trying to figure out how can we honor everyone in a way that's respectful, and we don't let our biases and the way that we see things blind our judgment or make us put up walls on each other. Because the whole thing of life is supposed to be, you know, that's why we have people who try to make peace and do different things, like to bring us together for diversity and all the variances of life. Like, there's no one way. And when you have someone thinking like 100 years ago, several years ago, decades and decades back, and not looking at what's happening right now, it's like a business that won't honor the fact that everything's digital. Mm-hmm. You know, and they're still mm-hmm. trying to crank out stuff manually every day. Right. And they're like trying to do what they think is the way it should be, but they're not looking at the time that they're in and the people that they have to identify with, no matter what their thinking is. And sometimes their thinking is from the past. Right. So if their thinking doesn't catch up, I think that's what makes for a lot of bias, is that people are so unwilling to change their stances because they think, I'm personally that stance. If I do anything from there, then I lose my whole self, which I don't think that's true, because when we go out and do different things, it doesn't mean that everybody I'm dealing with, right, I'm in a total agreement with them. Right. It doesn't mean that I'm just like them and that I can, you know, consent to everything they think and say. But at the same time, we have to have business exchange. We have to have a place where we know we all can go and not have someone sitting there with this judgment card, because we've come through a lot of history in the United States of all of this judging each other, mm-hmm, and then deciding who's in and who's out. And this is not what we want as a united country. That's right. Not at all.
All right, so the senior counsel, his senior counsel, his lawyer, Christian Wagner, said this: Jack serves all customers. He simply declines to express messages or celebrate events that violate his deeply held beliefs. Creative professionals who serve all people should be free to create art consistent with their convictions without the threat of government punishment. Without the threat of government punishment. That's what his lawyer said. So basically, she was saying, you know, he should be retained. He's creative individual.
Well, I think he's been punished enough with people not buying.
And that was another issue, too.
Supporting his business.
That was another issue, too. Okay, so my question is it enough to, because like you said, if somebody's not going to celebrate what you're trying to do or the event you're trying to have, you just go to somebody else. Mm-hmm. Is that what you would have done? Or would you have fought like this couple actually did?
Well, me, I'm going to speak up. But I still have a choice. We have a choice in life. And so I'm going to speak up, but I'm definitely going to not eat that cake. But well, so I would definitely go somewhere else. I think another part of that is, I think sometimes even in our fighting, can we at some point sit at the table and have a conversation?
Well, apparently, but he said that, though. He said that when they came in, he gave them the option. He was like, I can't do this, but we could do something else. And apparently they stormed off.
Okay.
And they wasn't trying to hear anything else. So is that still on him? Because he offered an alternative. So you come in, okay, let's say you come in.
No, because you know when you have a wedding or you have something big, you want what you want, whether it's a birthday party or whatever. Right. You want what you want.
Yeah, but I mean, is that, did he do his due diligence when he offered an alternative after he'd already said, I cannot do this because my beliefs, which dictates my business practices, would be in conflict, but I can offer you something else. So he was willing to work with them, and they were willing to compromise. So did he do his due diligence?
But guess what? When you're in the retail market is consumers. Really, if we would put up a you know, have everybody stand behind a curtain and just hand their money through a little, put their arm out, you're going to take that green dollar. So if you're in the retail arena, you can't have all of these personal beliefs. Now, when he heads out of that business and then he heads into his whatever, maybe he has a spiritual place he goes, or he has some social organizations he's part of, he's okay there, because they're going to write that everything he wants to be a part of in his individual life, he can do. But when he's on the retail market, which is the open market, and again, this takes us back to times where we were getting, you know, African Americans were getting turned away from businesses. I mean, you're traveling on the road, you need a bathroom, you need some food, and you can't even, and all the, I mean, a discussion of an alternative sometimes isn't there. I mean, if I need to eat and I need a place to be put up for the night, and, you know, this is where I'm at, or I can't get gas for my car. These, it's just not an option always to pick another place. And, you know, we have to have, either you're in business or you're not. Now, if he wants to now make up a Sam's Club for what he wants, and then everybody that signs up for his store, he can dictate what he's going to do, then that's a whole nother thing, because that's a club.
The reason why I say pick another place is because if I go somewhere and spend my money, I would want the same compassion and love put into something that you're feeling. So to have an experience of a wedding is something is very intimate. So mm-hmm. when you're coming to someone and saying, hey, this is a special day for us, we want this and we want that, and that person doesn't hold that same intimacy with you, then your product is not going to be of that. So even if he decided to say, okay, well, I'll give in and I'll make the cake, even though I don't feel that.
He wasn't going to put his love into it or something like that.
So that's
I want that cake for somebody that's begrudgingly making
me
a cake.
I personally would choose to go somewhere else. But I think the other component to that is I have been, the job I've had for years has been servicing people. I've had people sit in my chair as a barber to say, cut it all off. I don't want any hair. And I'm thinking, your facial, no, that's not going to work. But the customer, if that's what they want, that's what they want. Now, they have a choice to get up. Now, the difference is that's two different.
Yeah, but that's two different arenas.
Two different arenas. But also, in saying that, this is a business, like you say, there's some stipulations he could have posted.
Yes.
But then, too, I think maybe the way it came to him, maybe he didn't think about it. And so I think, too, even in business, I don't if it's nonprofit, for-profit, when we get into an arena of business, we have to understand that the world is changing.
Yes.
So any and everybody may come through our door at any time. And so those are things that we have to look at as a business owner before we approach certain things, that this is a stance that may come.
Didn't this affect Starbucks?
Exactly.
By identifying some type of group and somebody there. I'm not going to say the whole company, because obviously it's not happening every day, because right. I'm a customer and I have not been mistreated. I have not been mistreated, or I wouldn't go back I'd be on the protest side. So I know this is somebody's own prejudice, but at the same time, this business is a, you know, this is a global business.
That's right.
This is a, you know, a business being patronized by all diverse populations. So when someone does that and does identify a group and then starts to make a action based on that and a judgment, that is wrong right from the door.
That's
because
why I say
the business
they have
has
a right
to be
to protest and fight, because the end of the day, there is still this community that's being overlooked. There's still this community that's still fighting for their equality to say, our equal equality to be in a space with whoever we choose to love, and just be being in an environment that's conducive and happy for us without being looked upon because of somebody else's difference of belief, and to just be able to, you know, be free in who you are with all the stigma that comes with it. And that goes with any pretty much justice cause that you fight.
You know, they had something, I don't know where I saw this or heard it, but where a person was a Black Panther and then a person was a KKK member, and they actually older both realized that they both were seeing it from extreme sides, mm-hmm. and they were able to reconcile these mm-hmm. two. Now, that you know, that's totally different. They could not be put in the same room together without it being explosive. But as you start to say, you know what? That's a human being exactly. right there. And exactly. I consider myself a human exactly. being. I'm not Godzilla.
Right.
So we have to have some, we have to move past our ideologies. We have to move past our beliefs because some of our beliefs are wrong. People are believing right. in the boogeyman.
That's right.
People are believing in whatever. That's so right. And until there's some evidence and something to say why we can't get along and why just me being dealing with you is dangerous for us.
That's right.
And there's nothing that says that because there's, it's like when the 9/11 happened and Muhammad Ali, who's a Muslim, came out and said, I don't condone that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not my kind of Islam.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And people was instantly putting everybody who say they were a Muslim in the same boat. I got to watch you, and you're about mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Evil and this and that. And it's not the case.
That's right.
That means you're starting to just take a little group and make that a stereotype.
Take it off the top.
Yes, only one person's experience. And then they say, hey, I know your group. And they had one bad experience with one, you know, one person of a population that they're categorizing. So I think we're in the new millennium, and those old ideas of our parents and grandparents, mm-hmm. that's, some of them are still around. They're still haunting some people because they won't move past anything. Mm-hmm. They're holding on.
And it's okay for them to hold on to it.
Yeah.
But it's not, to me, it's not okay for you to inflict that into
yes.
someone else's life who has a disagreement of how they choose to live their lives.
Well, let's say this. Okay, so when we're talking about retail, this is not new. It's just, like y'all said, the time has changed.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go back to the early 2000s with the Tommy Hilfiger debacle. Anybody remember the Tommy Hilfiger debacle where Tommy at that time, I was a manager for Tommy at that time, so I know what happened.
Okay.
And that was like the early 2000s. Apparently, it was the statement, we can't say he actually said it because there was no actual factual evidence that he said it.
Okay.
But it was said that Tommy Hilfiger was in a meeting. He made the comment that his clothes were not made for minorities. He did not expect for them to be wearing his clothes. And at that time, Tommy Hilfiger was at the height of his success. And you had Aaliyah repping it and all these other name brand people or stars repping it. And I remember it because the packet came, how to deal with it when it comes up. Because I was in a retail store in Bluffton, South Carolina. But do we think if that happened now, would it be different? Because back then, they made a big deal about it. But again, there was no factual basis for it. But public opinion will get you every time. So it somehow it got viral, not to this capacity, because mm-hmm, in 2000 mm-hmm. it wasn't, social media wasn't this. You had MySpace, but
right.
it was mostly, I know most people don't know what MySpace is, but actually I think the three of us do know what MySpace is
because
we're not vegetarian
oh, yeah.
Morgan, so we know what.
It's like the first computer.
No, right. No, I'm only playing.
David Alec, you know, but I don't think so. I don't think so. So yeah, we had MySpace, and I think that was it. It was just MySpace.
I think that was it.
Oh no, Black Planet. So we have Black Planet, MySpace,
right.
which are not even remotely close
right.
to Facebook or, hell, just Facebook by
right.
itself.
Right.
True.
But do you think if that happened now, it would be different? Even without the factual basis, do you think the backlash would be different? Because back then, they made us think about it, but he was making billions. So he didn't really feel the effect of it. If that happened now and just being tried in public opinion and it hit the airwaves, oh my God, Tommy Hilfiger said, actually, let's use a better example. Les said that Gucci, because apparently that's the big thing now.
Yes.
That Gucci made the same comment, oh, well, I didn't expect for minorities to be wearing my clothing. Do you think it would be a whole different ballgame now because of social media, even though there would be no factual basis for it?
There's always going to be a backlash because of where we are now. It's not going back. So now that we have all the tools with social media, Facebook, Instagram, all of those engines that drive into, as soon as you take a clip of something and it goes, mm-hmm. it goes viral, there's no going back. So of course, if this was reversed, the backlash would be the same. I do believe.
All right. So on that note, we're going to take our first break. Everybody stick around. The Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice.
You're listening to IBNX. IBNXradio.com. The station with the
best
music.
Best music.
I love the music.
Best music.
Hey, what's up? It's Jay-Z.
Hey, I'm Mariah Carey.
Hey, it's Katy Perry.
It's your boy T.I.P., man. Get in.
It's your boy Sean Kingston.
What's up, y'all? I'm Beyonce.
This is Nicki Minaj, and I'm in the mix with
IBNX Radio.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see you from here. The matter of us lies in the atmosphere. Distance that we made too soon.
And you would say my name as if things were the same. I want you to.
And we drew maps so we could follow our tracks and feel brand new. Feel brand new. Feel brand new. 'Cause I wrote my love into your life. Da, 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 da. 'Cause I wrote my love into your life. Your life, life, life. 'Cause I wrote my love into your life. 'Cause
everybody, we are back on this week's edition of the Leadership Blend with your host Ricardi Wright and correspondent Chris White and our very special guest, Mrs. Erica Wright. So when we left, we were talking about the the cake debacle, as I like, the great cake debacle with the owner of Masterpiece Cake Ship in Colorado, Jack Phillips, and his actions to not make a cake for a same-sex couple based off his Christian beliefs. So when we left, I was talking about then versus now. So now when this happened, you know, it happened. I think this has been going on for about 6 years, and it made its way to the Supreme Court. I use the example of Tommy Hilfiger making the statement, which, again, was not confirmed or denied. He wasn't recorded because now, if they'd have been said now, somebody would have been in a meeting with a phone, and it would have been viral in 2 seconds.
So are you saying it was strictly rumor?
It was strictly public opinion.
Wow.
And then
and that
came
can
with,
kill a business.
Exactly. And that's the power. And when I say public opinion is when something hasn't been proven, but it's out there. Mm-hmm. So then everybody has everybody's weighed in on
so
it.
So is the National Enquirer in that group into?
You know,
everything you see. But you know what? I've heard that sometimes you see some things there that forecast something that's really coming sometimes. Like, mm-hmm. you can't hardly ever know because it's so much foolishness. I mean, people are, like, dancing with Martians and stuff like that on on the cover
really?
Also.
I mean, you know, and I guess the now with the creation of alternate facts, you really get into this world of what's – and I actually – and I said this last week. I actually feel sorry for people because at any given moment – like, I have NPR, CNN, and USA Today apps on my phone. Right. So anytime something happens, I get all these notifications. I swear over the weekend, just from immigration, I got about 15 messages in a day. Wow. So I'm like, we're bombarded with so much information. How do you decipher what's real and what's alternate facts? And now that we've made alternate facts a actual thing, you know, it sounds funny, but it's not funny because people are bombarded with so
you
much
information.
You
know what I'm thinking now with social media? This is kind of a dangerous time because people are relying on what's flying across their smartphone and across their laptops, and they're not doing, like, the source checking that mm-hmm. was done, you know, maybe a generation or two ago where everything was – you had to do your source checking before mm-hmm. you even start talking about something. Like, you better have your source straight. Now this source is anything that says .com.
Well,
so
I mean, but also not, then, too, look at social media and what – things that go viral that you see with your own eyes that you just cannot dismiss.
True. Now, if you have a, when you have a video and it's, you know, you have the person talking, but now we have all of these and people have several social media accounts and sometimes, you know, there's been hacking of all kinds of things. So in order to really be able to go out here and confront something, I think we need some of that old school source checking. That used to go on, and definitely if you're in media, they expect
news.
You to do some serious source checking before you go out here on this platform and have these strong opinions against something, come to find out it was somebody's alternative fact.
Well, okay, so I guess the question is, because somebody asked me this other day, we were talking about it, do you think that the stuff that we're seeing now has just started, or we just now are able to have access to it because of smartphones? Like the beatings and the stuff that's been going on with
I don't
the police
think it's
and stuff.
New. I think it's we have all kind of vehicles to cover because now everybody's a reporter if they have a smartphone with them. So we didn't have this before. We had to hear about it through the barbershop.
Right.
You know, you had to hear about what's going on, you know, through maybe a local politician or something that would come and have a town meeting with your or a block captain or something like that. So now we can be our own, I think Public Enemy said that's what, like, the music is. When you hear these lyrics, it's like them being the CNN of the street. And now we have the video and audio in the hands of the citizens. So, you know, we still have to check that out, make sure there's nobody doing anything with that.
All right, so our engineer wants to chime in. So, David, what are your thoughts?
So, I've been on the internet ever since y'all brought up this Tommy Hilfiger story because I was young when it happened, but I remember it being
How old are you, David?
I was born in 1993.
I think I was in high school. Okay.
That's cool. I'm the next generation. Just know that.
Yeah. Okay.
So I read three different sites just to make sure I had credible information, and it was told that.
Good job, David.
That
it depends on what the three sites
that
are.
That the Tommy Hilfiger, I don't know his I guess his name is Tommy Hilfiger.
His name is Tommy Hilfiger.
He was on Oprah Winfrey's show when he made those comments.
No, that's factual.
Not true.
On three different sites?
No, that's not factual. I am an Oprah fan, so I know who was on Oprah's show. He went on Oprah later to clean it up, but he didn't say that on Oprah's show. No.
He didn't say it on Oprah's show.
No.
Okay. He went to clean it up later.
That might have been Oprah Williams.
Yeah, that wasn't
the alternative.
That wasn't Oprah.
I don't know that person. I just wanted the fact check. I knew y'all had the facts for me. So I was trying to fact check.
That's an example. He went on Oprah later to clean it up.
Yes.
But the comment was not made on Oprah. He never went on Oprah. predating that comment being made. He went later.
See,
to clean
now
it up.
You have to check your fact check. Exactly. Look at Wikipedia. Look what happened with Hillary.
I don't use Wiki. That's true. But yeah, for sure, the internet got everything.
Yeah, a little bit of everything. But who's writing a little bit of everything?
But I think that's where we're going to have to start.
Yes.
Like, preparing kids to be able to decipher this information. Well, you have to create a class for that.
What happens is everybody wants everything now. So we're in a microwave web society now. So everything is so fast. And sometimes you're rushing to judgments. It almost goes to what a mob would do. A mob responds before there's any mm-hmm. fact. They don't wait for you to get mm-hmm. tried. They're just going after like vigilante justice on their emotion. And so we're like this is kind of why I think things have to, somebody has to really slow down, pump the brakes.
I don't know if, I hear you, but mm-hmm. I don't know if that is going to actually happen.
What?
Because look at what's going on in the White House. Look at everything that's mm-hmm. being said every day. And look at the press secretaries that stand before us and repeat certain things. And I mean, it doesn't take someone not living on the moon to understand that some things are just not true. And so I don't know, even if we had to fact check, would that be?
So with the social media, Erica, listen to this. Now, what happened with Roseanne Barr? Now that I'm thinking about it, it ran away and it became, it led to some serious consequence, like in a blink.
Other people.
Okay,
exactly.
Now,
yeah, but you
when
have
that first came,
that, though,
when that first
she
came
said
out,
on her Twitter.
Exactly.
But what I'm saying is, you know how people deny what's on their social media, that they say somebody else has access, could have done it?
Mm-mm.
Yeah,
what
but
I'm
you can't
saying
that
it happened on that case.
Yeah, but you can't do that.
No, I'm saying, and when you're looking on both sides of all of these things, like when statements are coming out, don't we need a little time? But that someone verified that, I guess, from the
corporation. Deleted, there is a way
for... nothing's ever really officially deleted.
Exactly. So it was brought back up.
But here's the thing. When it comes to celebrities' social media, with Twitter, for instance, there's a blue star that goes
right
on their profile and lets you know this is their official page.
Okay.
True.
So it came from her official page.
Right.
So there was no getting around that.
And then
you
have a lot of people that's quick with their phone. So what they do is they'll click that.
Yep, they'll take
so
a screenshot.
Like, oh, I know
they'll screenshot it. And then so there was no way, which actually segue into that, I think they're actually in talks to create a show called The Conners.
They are.
Without Roseanne.
Yes.
And I think they should, because other lives were affected just by one person's
comment. So it's kind of just going to be a spinoff, actually, because... You know how the Jeffersons came off of the All in the Family and different things like that? Because this is without Roseanne. I mean, Roseanne was the draw. I mean, you have the family.
I think
this could do well for
but
itself.
But I think even with think that, so. Whether it's successful or whatever, I'm a minister. So my thing is I believe in forgiveness. And so whereas you're going to have
for forgiveness.
You're going to have...
Need more of it.
You're going to have this component where... You'll see something, we are quick to jump on it, we're quick to shut a business down, we're quick to protest.
Yes.
But then we also still have to have that heart and compassion to say, hey, this is a disease maybe of the mind for that person.
True.
Or this is what was going on in this particular person's lives at that time. So do we just condemn everybody for every little thing that may happen? So, you know, because Tommy makes some nice clothes. You know what I mean?
I know.
some people like Roseanne's show. So as a whole.
I loved it. I loved it.
So what I'm saying as a whole, as a community,
I still see
as
people
a world,
with the Gucci bags
to,
and the Gucci
exactly.
shoes.
Well, I mean, that was just an example. He didn't say. Okay, let me.
What
he didn't say that. That was just an example I used. Gucci did not say that. That was just an example I used. If he'd said that, would people stop, especially this generation,
right.
Would people stop wearing his clothes?
So even if you, if the choice is yours, not to purchase the cake, but not forgive the person. Because
well,
this
say,
person could have a compassionate heart and say, you know what, I was wrong. I'm going to make you the best cake.
But you already said you wouldn't eat the cake.
Now,
isn't there something spiritual?
You already said you wouldn't eat the cake.
But because
so.
Of what he was feeling. But I'm just saying, as this world that we're living in and everything that's going on, if we start really getting back to compassion and start getting that underlying surface of conversations and these little snapshots and Twitters and this, and I just see the world in a whole different perspective.
Yeah, no, it's, I see unicorns and flowers in your world, Erica. It's beautiful.
But guess what?
Like,
with this
so
masterpiece case, what if this owner changes from this. See, some things take change.
Exactly.
Some things take getting very messy.
Mm-hmm.
before they get better.
Well, let me say this.
This could end up being a changed catalyst for that owner to learn something from this.
Yeah,
we don't know yet.
Almost going out of business didn't change his mindset or change his stance, the likelihood is not very high because he almost went out of business for this. And he still stood on his beliefs. He still stands on his belief.
And I agree with him for standing on his belief. Even if he went out of business and that's what he believed in, he fought for his cause. The same way that a same-sex couple is fighting for their justice cause. So that's always the elephant in the room.
now it's going before the court to get this decided, because when we can't handle things, we gotta call in Big Papa, the government.
So okay, well, sticking with that forgiveness vein.
Okay.
So if Roseanne came out and said, "I'm sorry for my statement, I didn't mean it," what would be the remedy? Should they give her a show back?
Well, I think she has apologized.
Yeah,
I think she has apologized. I don't think it was heartfelt through other people's eyes. Let me say that. So for me, I think it starts always at the top. Whoever the boss is, if the boss is saying, you know, Roseanne, let's sit down, let's talk about it. They bring in the team, and that's something that they agree on. Let's bring it back. But like you just said, when it first came out, and the producer or whoever of the show,
she
decided we're done. Guess what? That was it. But there again, you had how many people that lost their jobs?
Yeah, it was a lot.
A lot of people that lost their jobs. And so I think, again, sometimes before we just go be drastic, I think we should kind of have that.
But it seems like the timing is, sometimes the timing has everything to do with how it goes down. And we had brought this up in a previous show where I brought up the fact that when Malcolm X made a statement after JFK had just got assassinated, he's been saying these same things prior to this assassination, but he was told to be quiet right then.
Right.
Because if you say it and the country's in mourning, mm-hmm. it has a big, your words have a, it's just the timing.
Powerful.
And the same with, we had talked about that Roseanne Barr made these statements right when the Starbucks was dealing with that mm-hmm. big, national.
But I think what happened with
outcry.
Roseanne, that wasn't the first time
and,
she had said.
Oh no!
If she had any self discipline on how she feels, and done it, you know, through her show way, she could have done things and all kind of other. Because you're able to have a platform and kind of the attitude you have on these shows, she probably has power over some of the content, and you can demonstrate, like how Archie Bunker did in All in Family. He had a lot of things he put out that were very racy, very, you know, polarizing, but it had people tune in because they said there is somebody out there that thinks like mm-hmm. that. So he actually put stuff out there for us to have to talk about.
Right.
Even if you didn't like what he was, you know, and I think she would have had, if her timing, because it during that time when they were going to the bias training and all that at all the Starbucks, she made her statement right when they were about to do the training. And the whole country is very sensitive to what happened to those two gentlemen in Philadelphia. And it just showed that there was no self-control. I'm just saying that the timing is just bad on somebody who could have just kept their...
But is it that the timing is bad, or is it that we are not really still being in a position where we're able to speak our authentic piece and be heard without being criticized? Because even if that's who she is, even if that's what she said and that's what she believed in, we each as individual have our own perspective on what we see or how we want to talk. It's just that where you sit, sometimes you just can't say what you want to say.
But guess what? This all ties in.
That timing was. Mm-hmm. It wasn't about the timing. It was just that you have to be, when it's just, for instance, as a minister, when you take it upon yourself to stand up on a platform and say, this is who I am, people are ready. You got the ball. They ready to tackle you. You got the bullseye. And as soon as you make one wrong move, your whole career can be over with just because of that one incident.
And on that note, that takes me to Kim Burrell.
Okay.
When Kim Burrell stood in front of that congregation and made those comments about homosexuals, mm-hmm. and everybody immediately stopped.
Okay.
And I think that same week she was supposed to appear on Ellen, because it was the same time that Hidden Figures had just came out.
Oh, I remember
that. And her and Pharrell had that song, which I loved. Oh man, what's the name of it? I can hear it in my head. What is the name of it? Any event, her and Pharrell Williams had a song, and Ellen had invited them to come on the show, and that video went viral of her bashing homosexuals in a pulpit somewhere, and Ellen uninvited her to the show. For Kim Burrell, that would have been huge, because Kim Burrell was never a mainstream artist. Right. Going on Ellen would have made her a mainstream artist, and the platform she had at that time. And that's not uncommon, especially in black church and homosexuality. They don't really mix very well.
Right.
So it wasn't uncommon. Somebody videotaped her making those comments.
Guess what the theme is of everything I'm hearing? Green. The fact is, this affects somebody's money. The decision here in Masterpiece, this is somebody who's feeling, you know, like I can do this, which might hurt me with my money on the consumer side, but let me do this. And then the consumer is saying, I have green power. What if I polarize my group against this? And the same with Roseanne Barr. When she made the statements, it wasn't just Roseanne Barr a person, because that wouldn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. It's Roseanne Barr that's going to have endorsements on the show. Mm-hmm. And do they want to be part of how she's acting? Because the statements everybody has, you know, we could sit around and put 10 people in a room at a local pub, and everybody's got 1,000 of the same opinion she's talking about. But do you want your money attached to Roseanne Barr in their statement? That's where it got. She had to be.
Well, you can't
let
ask
go.
Me that
because
the
money.
I don't operate.
It's all
like
about
that.
The money. It's all about the money.
Well, but
it's all about.
But
the
I agree with you. But I'm probably the wrong person to ask.
Well, no, because I think it's principle too, because there was a lot of money on the stage. Actually, there was more money in viewership in the Roseanne debacle than any other scenario we've brought across the table to date.
Right.
Because remember, Roseanne brought in 18 million views, which is numbers that ABC hadn't seen in almost a decade.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So Channon, who is a black female who's over the ABC, that particular branch, and Roseanne's boss, she made the call swiftly to say, I don't care about these 18 million views we've not seen. Mm-hmm. Who, and they'd already renewed her show for the second season.
Yes.
Before they even got to renewing season.
Right.
They renewed it. So Channon went against all that and said, you know what? I don't care. We will not stand for this. This is not the principles that we hold near and dear here at ABC. So forget the 18 million views. We're canceling your show.
So what percentage would you say if it was morals versus money?
I think in both, even with the Ellen and Kim Burrell, it was a principle thing, because it's not like Ellen was hurting for
a
ratings.
But
it's
also principle. I think what I'm seeing too in this culture of people making a decision like that is morals sifting back in.
Ooh, I would love to think we're going that route.
Well, that's what we were talking about.
But I know money is moving the world in a lot of ways.
I'm not the right person to ask that.
But that's when we talked about, because the Roseanne debacle was like 2 shows ago, and that's the angle I brought it from.
Mm-hmm.
Have we gotten back to the table where we're saying that our ethics are more near and dear to us than the bottom line? Because and that's what Roseanne, the whole conversation sparked, because we haven't had that conversation in a long time. Mm-hmm. Everybody was like, well, it's the bottom dollar, and I guess we got to suck it up and just call it what it is. And in that scenario, 18 million viewers is a lot of viewers for ABC, because even in Scandal's heyday, Scandal brought in maybe 11 or 12.
That's billions of dollars over years.
You're talking about American Idol numbers and Empire is first season. When you're talking about 18 million views, that is a lot of people to bring into your network. And the ideology is, hey, if we can get those 18 million eyes to look at some of our other shows, hey, we can diversify our stock and make these numbers go up. So to sacrifice 18 million views that you've not seen in a decade to say, you know what? I'm sorry, our principles are more near and dear to us.
But,
and
your principles, let's go back to the Ellen show. Your principles were, you knew what you felt before you would even accept an invitation to go on a show where you know that the host is gay. So I think we all need to look in the mirror before we leave out the house and make a decision on what we are, who we are, and how we're going to present to the world, and stay with that.
Well, I guess the question with Kim Burrell is, because she later was like, well, you know, no, that's not really how I feel. You know, my hairstylist is gay. I let gay people live in my house,
what
blah,
does
blah,
that
blah,
mean?
Blah. Well, but it's the same thing somebody would say if a white person would say about a black person, they were caught using the N-word.
Right.
Well, you know, all my friends are black, and, you know, I went to their church and blah, blah, blah. You know.
So, Ricardo, you did mention that it affected her brand, right? Because you said if she was able to get on that show, it would give her a larger audience, which it turns into ching ching on, you know, you're out there more, maybe more sales, maybe more invitations for concerts and all types of things. So I think I'm hearing you both on this, because I do see that the Roseanne Barr issue had that ethics, the principles, and the fact that a so-called minority African-American woman was the one who was out there, you know, making sure that show became, you know, back in existence. And then she also made the call on that these principles that she attacked with these statements, this is a no-go, you know? So,
well, it's all about who's calling the shots, because in both scenarios, in the ABC scenario, the female is an African-American female. In the Kim Burrell situation, right, Ellen is an LGBTQ forerunner. So you're talking about on both sides, because on the lower side with Roseanne, this is her money. This is her livelihood. With Kim Burrell, this is also her money. This is her livelihood.
Right.
On the other side with the people calling the shots for Channing canceling this show, which, by the way, she didn't have to ask permission. She made that decision without having to make a phone call.
Right.
She made it. It was done. Mm. Ellen, same thing. She made that decision. It was done.
Wow, that's big
so
time.
So it's a matter
that's
of...
Well, that was a big time a for her to make that decision. But also, you need to look at all of the community in which the show possessed. You had LGBT people on the show. You had a black young lady on the show. I mean, the demographic of everything that they were talking about on the show did not depict what Roseanne had to say. Not just one time on Twitter, but her little rantics that she would say. So at some point, going back to that moral component, wherever you sit, high or low, you have to make some type of decision based on the ethics of where we're trying to take this. So if this is a show of diversity, and we want to bring the community together, and we have one person that's being divisive, I got to make a decision.
I mean, this is true. So, I mean,
they say social media is a nebulous thing. It has a good and bad of it. And so it end up, as good as it is as far as engaging with people instantly, daily, and all over the world, it also has this, the other side of it is you can also put your foot in your mouth sitting right in your house.
But again, we're talking about the social media component, because had somebody not been in service with Kim Burrell and recorded her saying this,
right,
and it goes back to what you said, this is not stuff that people don't know that these people feel. Like, I'm sure Kim has preached before in a holiness church, and more than likely holding a church, and made those comments, and people were just kind of like, well, you know, it's Kim, and we love her music, so, you know, long as it's not, you know, a lot of people, the right people in the audience, it is what it is. With Roseanne Barr, she has a history of saying things like this. She just crossed the line.
Even that national anthem, you know, they show some respect for it. But you know what? They should have known. When you hire a comedian, aren't you already saying, I got a bozo, right? Aren't you already saying, Joy I got Behar somebody that's going to goof off? That. So when she messed around with that anthem and did her Roseanne Barr and took them.
You know, we have young listeners, so they probably know what that is.
But I mean, she really blew it.
David probably doesn't know what that is. But some years ago,
when you hired them,
Roseanne was asked to sing the national anthem, and she kind of degraded it by not really singing it well. And then at the end, I think she grabbed the crouch and stuck up her middle finger. But I will get the specifics on that. But I pretty much remember that's what happened. So Roseanne has a history of being quite vulgar and really crossing the line. So the question really does become, why that particular day? Because what she said wasn't all that far-fetched the stuff she said in the past. Mm-hmm. So why that day? Nobody ever knows, even with Kim Burrell.
But then did you hear what I was saying about that? Those last like couple weeks was all the attention was on how those gentlemen in Philadelphia got treated, and that we really had the discussion of bias. And what was the term that they had about bias? It's some term where it's like unconscious bias. And so we had this whole thing going on in America. At the same time, Roseanne Barr puts out her own personal, you know, rant. It's just like I was saying about Malcolm X. If he was told to be sensitive, at least right after the assassination, not saying going forward a week or two, a month later, then go back on your, you know, fighting for civil rights.
But that
rights.
Goes back to what you just said about the social media part. So here we have a situation where one person made a phone call based on what they felt, and it took a whole company to almost go into a spiral downward motion. Now, I love Starbucks. I don't have a problem with Starbucks. I'm like you. I've never had bad experience going there. But one person's experience and what they put out on social media and how it went viral could have shut Starbucks down.
True.
Based on, like you say, not going back to do the research. But I do like the way the CEO came right back out and said, hey, let's get into having this sit down conversation about where we need to go from here. And I think if a lot more people take that approach, it may change.
True,
some
Erica.
Things.
True.
It may change some things.
Maybe. Okay.
Then I'm paying $10, right?
I know, right? I'm still not going to Starbucks, but it's not because of that. I don't, my thing with Starbucks is, and I use this a lot when I'm doing classes on marketing and things of that magnitude, because the culture that Starbucks created, they are the best example ever of marketing genius.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and I'll use two clowns, as it, mm-hmm. I'm sure on 100 degrees, like it's almost 100 degrees outside. And Chris is sitting here with
thank
a cup
you,
of Starbucks.
Ricardo.
Like it's almost 100 degrees outside.
I feel the love.
But he's sitting here with a Starbucks cup of coffee.
Their brand.
On 100 degrees outside.
Yeah.
What does that say about their marketing?
Yes.
Starbucks is genius when it comes to marketing. Why? Because they created a whole culture around their coffees. So
yes.
Now you feel like it became a class thing. Oh, because I remember when it first came out. Oh, you know, if you have a cup of Starbucks, that means you're in the elite group. You know, you probably have
no,
a
no, that's not it for me.
Blah, 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 I work
from home, and I don't do well at home. So I like to...
Right, they didn't create
yeah,
a working,
but, yeah,
working
but
space.
But you have other choices. You have Dunkin' Donuts. You can get
but
you a
it's,
QT
it's nothing
coffee.
Like the environment. Now, for instance, I don't know if you've ever been to D.C. and been to Busboy and Port.
No.
Oh, my God. It's just pretty much the same as Starbucks. It's like a laid-back... relaxing place. You have your coffee.
David said their coffee is even that good.
Which place? Which place, David?
Starbucks.
For me, it's not about
I drink coffee
it's
every
about
day.
The
Starbucks is subpar.
Yeah, I'm not moved by it either.
It's about the atmosphere.
Hey, actually, I like Dunkin' Donuts. If I'm gonna drink coffee, I actually like Dunkin' Donuts, which I try not to drink.
But you know
coffee,
what? It depends on the people that come there. It depends on the quality you're looking for, because they do is more expensive, but they have. But if you just want a basic drink, you can get it for, you know, almost comparable to your other places. But when you want to get something where you're like, I really need something with stronger caffeine. I really need a real bean versus, you know, like the I think is Arabica or something like that, where it's like higher in the mountains, you know, Kenyan coffee,
you're
Jamaica Blue Mountain coffee. If you want those type and they're authentic, and then you might say, I like it. And also, it's one thing that I noticed in there. I have never seen more patient customers than the customers in that. Like you said, the way they branded it and the clientele that they bring in, I think it's more about making the people feel like they're in a better class of something.
You can't beat that.
They're zombies.
Anything.
And you're
because
one too.
You're I've never seen anybody in the line ever argue. Like about or pacing around, like, come on now, that kind of thing. It's as if it has a culture that they've created. Business culture.
I have to agree with David. You sound brainwashed. And there was
I am
no
a
logistic.
Zombie, David.
There was no logistics to that argument. I mean, it's just, again, Starbucks for me, and you'll find most marketing professors use Starbucks as an example because, again, the socioeconomic status they put around or class they put around their coffee, it's amazing. The mere fact you're sitting here willing to psychobabble about, you know, validation for buying a $10 cup of coffee.
It comes with a free back massage, too.
Yeah, right. Who's the point? I mean, it's
and free marketing. Internet.
And a car wash that you wanted, right,
marketing
Erica?
Marketing genius. Absolute marketing genius. So, I mean, look, at the end of the day, they're marketing geniuses.
Yeah.
And, you know, the question, again, the underlying question becomes, everybody's entitled to free speech.
Mm-hmm.
But when does that stop being protected? Becomes a question.
True.
Once you acclimate to a certain position, too much is given, much is required.
That's right.
So do we really hold? But then you start getting into these. Everything leads to another debate.
Mm-hmm.
Because then you start getting into how do we hold certain people to different standards?
Right.
Like you said, Roseanne's a comedian. Mm-hmm. Comedians are automatically given a lot of leeway.
Right.
So why do we tighten the rope on this? She's a comedian.
But if she had done it in a comedic vein and not trying to act like she's some kind of political figure, and like I said, I believe it was the timing. I'm telling you, sometimes it's you know how it is, even in regular relationship things. It's what they say. It's not what you say is how you said it, and it's the time you said it. Like if somebody just had a bad day and you say something, and then you say the same thing on a good day, and they're more tolerant. I think that's part of it.
Yeah, but I don't think that carries in this particular situation. I think it's just more than that. I think that she said it, and I think that it was so egregious what she said. Like, you compared, and it's I think it's the variables that were in it. You brought in the Muslim Brotherhood, then you brought in Planet of the Apes, and then you compared African American, which there's already a stigma with apes and African Americans. So I think it was just what she said. You know, it was a line crossed you can't come back from.
Yeah. She showed her tail.
But she always does. That's not anything new. Roseanne is known for doing that, because those kind of antics. She's known for it. Yeah. So ABC knew that going into it. So
but again, even like you said, I agree with him. Even in this time, going back to the White House, and where we are in the community and what's going on around us with all of the hate-filled messages and the, you know, the separation of people, it's disheartening. And so I think, you know, even just as an adult, just being responsible for what comes out of your mouth in this time, and having a crew that's so, and you know, we're diverse, so you just think about some things before you put it.
I think it's kind of hypocritical, because I bet if she was on like Netflix or something like that, where they're given a lot more liberty than to be on broadcast stations. So it's ABC. That she was on.
Yeah.
Am I correct? So ABC, I think on one side, they want to portray things as a, you know, American culture of being like the Leave It to Beaver kind of, we got to have family values. And then on the other side, you watch like those cartoons, I think like Adult Swims and different things where you have things that are really kind of like, wow, a child might watch this, and it's like getting very, you know, opinionated and saying some fiery things. Some of those, right? So at the same time, when some of these network programs that aren't like now, where we have all of these other things now with the streaming programs, I think they're trying to still hold on to like we're America's values kind of thing, and I think that also played into it a little bit. Versus if you get onto these other programs, it's like going when Howard Stern went on to Sirius Radio, and he had a lot of issues when he was on regular radio. Mm-hmm. So when you get on Sirius Radio, you have more liberty to act like you're, you know, doing like a kick, because it's a subscription. So then I can say a little more, and I can be a little more fired up and be who I want to be. But when you're going to do broadcasts, you know, our main three from history in the United States, then you're on that where they want to, at least on the surface, look like we're going into family values.
That go back to what you just said about money, and people are sitting in the room and they're talking about their money.
All right, so on that note, we're going to take our second break. We'll stick around the leadership plan with the host, Ricardo Rice.
Go, Erica.
You're talking about that money.
Say that you're wonderful, but it doesn't seem good enough. I can say that you're kind, but that would miss the mark. I can say that you're beautiful, but to me you are so much more. How do I communicate exactly who you are? I'm trying to convey the sentiment of my heart and say I really do appreciate the way you brighten up my day. I would go down the line and name all the things that captivate my heart. But clearly I'm not aware of words
that can compare. How do I communicate exactly who you are? I'm trying to convey the sentiments of my heart and say I really do appreciate the way you cry.
Here we go.
All right, everybody, welcome to this week's edition of the Leadership Band with your host, Ricardo Rice, and our very special guest, Erica Wright, and correspondent Chris White. So when we left, we were all over the place talking about free speech, because at the end of the day, that's what it boils down to. How much is too much as it pertains to infringing on somebody's right to have free speech? But we're going to table that because we do have a guest, but we're going to go to Chris first. All right, Chris, look, now you're going to be... Everybody knows Chris is very long-winded. We love you. This is
family.
But he does not do anything in a short time span. So today is your practice. You have 10 minutes because then you can start infringing on Erica's time. So you have 10 minutes to do your segment. Take it away.
Wait, what? And I have 10 minutes. I got to be quick, guys. This is a microwave generation. And I gotta go there.
You just lost two.
You see what I mean?
You just lost two.
All right, so this is one. It really took me aback because on appearance, I thought I was looking at just straight up a business that started from an entrepreneurship spirit, and that's what it was about. And then when I really went into it, I ended up finding out I've discovered that the big business of Amazon is a political organization. And I had no idea that they were so big into lobbying in Washington, D.C. So much that the CEO, Jeff Bezos, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right, he has purchased the Washington Post, which means he's using that as a sounding board to help with his lobbying for different rights and legislation that's going to help out Amazon. So, you know, I had no idea that lobbying was going on to these measures with businesses and, you know, with Amazon being as huge as they are. It says Mr. Bezos has built one of the largest lobbying operations in Washington, bigger than those of powerhouses such as ExxonMobil and Walmart. They have 3 Washington area locations among the 20 finalists for its planned second headquarters. Amazon could become a big part of the capital's social fabric. Now, it says inside the government, President Donald Trump is among the company's biggest challenges. So here we go getting into politics, which I said I had no idea that Amazon was so big into politics, and definitely from their CEO stance. It says Trump is one of the company's biggest challenges, regularly attacking Mr. Bezos and Amazon for a range of sins, which he states are avoiding taxes, shutting down traditional retailers, and using the U.S. Postal Service as their delivery boys. To aid in this battle, Amazon now has an army of nearly 100 lobbyists at more than a dozen lobbying firms working on a list of issues including taxes, trade, government procurement, internet policy, drone regulation, grocery rules, music licensing, and more recently, food stamps. Last year, the company spent $13 million on lobbying. Mr. Bezos, building his own personal ties in the area, spent $250 million of his own money to acquire the Washington Post. And being that the Washington Post is in D.C., which means they're going to have such a strong stance on trying to sway policy right there on the Hill and with our government, I'm have a wait what on. How is this should a retailer be so involved in politics? Is buying a newspaper in D.C. Ethical when it comes to lobbying for your business? I mean, is anybody going to listen to what's coming through that media channel as being legitimately objective? Or is this just the arm of Amazon pushing for their own things, and they'll be on different sides of issues, different sides of figures, both, you know, politicians and otherwise. And is Amazon trying to monopolize and destroy entrepreneurship which was the same way that they got started as a big online book supplier. They got started with that spirit of entrepreneurship, but now it looks like entrepreneurship has gone to D.C., has gone to Washington. So the way what is, I had no idea so much was being spent on lobbying from a big giant retailer where they're so involved in it, they're almost political. So that's where I'm at with this, that I don't know about the ethical side of owning a paper that's right in Washington. It's owned by a big retailer that wants legislation changed so that it makes them have an advantage. And like they had said, when Walmart was destroying all those small businesses all over the United States and probably the world, putting them out with, it's making people have to get creative to get business. And they said it is an upswing on that people are getting creative to compete with a big conglomerate like a Walmart. But with the Amazon owning so much of the online market, is this ethical? Wait, what?
Well, at the end of the day, and this is what I try to tell people, particularly because I live in Atlanta, he who controls the politics controls the conversation. Mm-hmm. And that's why people spend so much money lobbying. What is a lobbyist? A lobbyist is somebody who's been paid to stay in Washington and advocate for your interests. Yes. So why pay a lobbyist? Because that's what they do. They stay in Washington every day. They try to get in a congressman's ear or a senator's ear. Hey, you know, this is what we're trying to do. So when you make this policy, you know, if you add in this clause, we'll do X, Y, Z. That's all a lobbyist does every day, all day. They stay at Washington. They try to affect. So case in point, let's say that legislation AB64, which talks about Amazon accepting food stamps, is getting ready to hit the floor. Amazon has a lobbyist that they pay to stay in Washington all day to find out what this legislation is going to say. So they get in somebody's ear. He's like, hey, you know, we're trying to find out about this legislation because we know that we want to accept EBT, blah, 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 the dynamics, whatever. They get into this guy, the congressman's ear. He goes, well, this is what they're thinking about saying. Well, hey, if you sway them to do this, 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 and write this in, we'll do X, Y, Z. That's all a lobbyist does all day, every day. So that's why it's so pertinent, and that's why they pay them so much money, because in essence, it's kind of like having a little mini lawyer advocating for your interest. So it's a big deal. Lobbyists is a big deal. But, you know, again, he who has the legislative power is who controls the narrative. And I tell people that about Georgia. Yeah, this is cute that we have the housewives and all that stuff, and that's cute. But it's those politicians who sit up there making policy that they pass on an everyday basis. They're the ones that have the real political power. And political power is what controls the tide. And that's the reality.
And everything is political.
Business, everything.
And it goes back to what you said earlier. Money is green.
The root of all evil.
That's right.
The love of money. All right. So, that's at the end of the day, that's the kind of power you want is political power. That's the kind of power you want. Because it doesn't go away. It transcends.
True.
Yeah. All right. So, in the house today, we have Mrs. Erica Wright, who is the founder and CEO of You First Incorporated. So, tell us about yourself, dear.
Hey. I don't know you guys.
She's been here the whole day. So yeah. You kind of, that's the voice you've been hearing all day.
Well, hi, my name is Erica Wright, and I am the CEO and founder of You First Incorporated. You First is a nonprofit 501c3 organization that I founded about 3.5 years ago, almost 4 years now. And basically what we do is provide health and hygiene items for our homeless community. We've done a little bit of everything. We fed the homeless, we clothed the homeless, but God really brought me back to the forefront of what the vision was, and that is to keep our homeless and our community clean. And so right now I don't have a facility. I work out of a couple of storage units on Peter Street. I've had up to 5 storage units because that's how God has blessed us with so much inventory. And so So what we do on a monthly basis, that right now, since we can't go out to the streets to feed the homeless community here in Atlanta, so what we do is put our hygiene kits together, and we disperse them to different shelters in Atlanta, focusing on those who need them. There are a lot of shelters, misconception that everybody gets grants, that they have everything that they need, and that's not true. Mm. And so that's where we come in. We also, there's another component that I want to put in place later on with the mental illness, with our homeless community, trying to get people off the streets and into housing. But that's a little bit down the line. That's pretty much what we do.
Look, if you don't open the door, I'm not asking. If you don't open the door, I'm not asking the question. So,
well, come on in.
So what made you get started on this journey? Like, what was the catalyst to, because this is, you have to follow her, like, Facebook, I think LinkedIn, Instagram. Too, definitely Facebook, okay. to see the amazing work that she does. Like, we're not talking about one or two bags. We're talking about hundreds to, fastly approaching thousands of bags that, you know, right. are giving to these individuals who happen to be homeless. So what, because again, people know that I started a nonprofit and I was like, I'm, you know, I love people and all, but right. I'm not about to spend the rest of my life begging for money or resources, right. so I can't do this.
Right.
But you managed to continue to do it.
My personal story is I'm a Georgia peach, here in the city of Atlanta.
You're one of a few. Yay, for Georgia peaches.
I am the last of four children from my awesome parents, Min and Leroy. I give them a shout out. I have a 21-year-old son.
Seriously?
And yes, I do. And so,
okay.
I found myself in the second half of my life, and I was broken. I had gone through several relationships, just you know, life. And so I found myself back in my parents' home and saying, this is not me. And so I'm a praying person. I've been a spiritual person all my life. I'm so grateful to my parents that they introduced me to God.
Please tell me you're a PK. You're not a PK, are you?
No.
Oh, okay, I'm
going to
make sure.
No.
PK is preacher's kid. Just
blessed. But my parents introduced me to God. And so I had my own relationship with God. Mm. And so basically, I was broken, and I said, God, I know you have more for me in my life than doing what I'm doing. So a barber of 24 years, I used to work at Greenbrier Barbershop, and I would often stand back there cutting hair, love what I do, meeting great people. And I said, I know you have more for me. So I saw this lady washing her hair up under the bridge under 75 one day I was going to work, and it just hit me. How do the homeless community get the simple necessities of life? The simple things that we take for granted. Mm. So one morning I was in the bathroom brushing my teeth, and then later on I saw this guy in front of the storefront on Peter Street. He had a bottle of water, and he was literally brushing his teeth and shaving his head. And I sat there for a moment, and I watched him. And then I went on about my business, and I came back. And then when I saw him cross the street, he didn't look homeless. He was clean. Mm. And so, again, it never left my spirit. And so I was at church. I used to go to Victory for the World. And I was talking about my purpose in Sunday school. And two ladies start bringing items the next week. And I said, I want to put kits together to give to the homeless. And that's literally how I got started. So I started to pray. And so August the 7th, 2014, God woke me up in a dream. And I wrote like Paul. I wrote, I have never written that much in my life. And I posted the prayers on the wall.
That's how you know it's God.
And so the name You First, everything that I saw, the vision, where we would go global, how it would look, who we would serve. Now, the thing is, I didn't have any money. I didn't have any credit. I didn't have a blueprint. So I was really at a disadvantage of how it was going to come together. And so one of the components that God gave me was to use social media, going back to what we were just talking about.
The power of social media.
And so the first batch of items that was given to me, I posted on social media. I just put it all strategic. I have OCD, so I like to put things a certain way. And it became contagious. And so people started to just send things or, hey, where are you? I want to give it to you. And so I'm like, okay, well, we're going to go out and give it to people. So we started going to the park. We would go to Renaissance Park near the old shelter where Cortland and Pine. We would go there. And then it became an experience for me because we started to invite the people, the homeless people started inviting us into their homes. Oh. See, people don't realize when you approach a homeless person, this is a community. This doesn't belong to you because we're already on the outs. Mm. You don't want us out in, so we don't want you in. So you have to not just come with something, but you have to come with the compassion in your heart to sympathize, have empathy for where they are. And I'm not talking about from a judgmental space.
Not pity, but respect.
That you have endured rain last night. You endured all kind of insect bites and so on and so forth. So survive. That right there, that survival mode that we were able to experience, led me to serve the homeless community in a different capacity of what I had seen from other organizations. And so for me, not saying that they had a lack of compassion, but I just wanted to serve the homeless. So we would set up the tables and we would have the homeless to come and we would do sack lunches and hygiene kits and clothing. And so Delta Airlines did a coat drive for me about 2 years ago, and they donated coats and we brought them out and put them on the table. And I met this guy named Billy Reynolds. And he said, well, Erica, how did you get this stuff here? And I said, in my 2008 Honda Civic. And so from that point, Billy said, Erica, I can probably get the truck to help you on some occasions. And so I developed the relationship with Billy, and Delta has been a vital part in helping us pull you first together, along with loving people who I've met along the way, who saw us on Facebook, who came out and said, hey, I want to be a part of it. And so now we have a family. I call it a family. It's not just volunteering. We are a family. So if you want to volunteer, please, like you said, go. If we're on Facebook, LinkedIn. The letter is U, the space, and then the word first. And so so with that, moving forward, I had the opportunity to have a small office on Peter Street. And so I would do my day-to-day functions as a business. And I found myself experiencing homelessness myself. I had exhausted all of the little funds that I had, and through my brokenness and also suffering, I don't want to say suffering, my experience with depression, bipolar, and anxiety, I was in a downward spiral. I wanted to commit suicide. I laid on that floor many days not knowing how did I get here. I just wanted to help someone. I had a nice little income coming in. I was able to.
You were a barber, so I mean, yeah, that I alone. Was
shoot, you know, I can go get my hustle on, right? Mm. But I really kind of overexerted a little bit. But I also knew that God was taking me through a transformation for me to be able to be clear on the mission. And so now I'm very clear. So one night I was laying there, and it was the office, and we didn't have like a rooftop to the office. So you could hear everything that was going on in the office. You had to be out at a certain time, and you come in at a certain time. And so one morning I would get up and I had to move my car early. So I had to go in the restroom and clean up and move my car and then come back in the office like nobody. Hey, good morning. How you doing? And so for me, it was at first I was humiliated. I was like, I felt dirty. I felt so many different things because I had to go into a public restroom to clean up, whereas I had my own space. And so it taught me that I was no different from the lady on Broad Street who was sleeping in a box. And so everything that I went through, and, you know, I had friends and family say, hey, well, Eric, you don't have to be there. But I was like, no, this is.
I was saying, because you live with your
parents. Yeah, well, yeah, we had some issues. But, you know, but I knew that those issues, and I'm an adult. I'm a grown woman. And my parents are grown. And it wasn't just that. It was just that I needed to go through that because I got exactly what I asked for. I asked God.
Oh God!
To give me my purpose in life.
Do it.
And so once I surrendered my life to God and to do the purpose and the will in which God asked me to do, that's it. The rest is history. And so here we are in our fourth year, and we have done some extraordinary numbers. Sometimes I go back and look at the pictures and I weep because I can remember every place I was. I can remember the person that I was talking to and their circumstances. I had an opportunity 2 years ago to go to California.
I was about to ask
with
about
a friend of mine whose father was sick. And she took me to L.A. And I could not believe the homeless population in L.A. And so at that particular point, I knew then that I was really on a journey. This was not just something I was getting ready to do, like you say.
Yeah,
this is it. And so I have dedicated my life to You First and to helping those in need. And so right now, our mission is, again, not only to keep our homeless community clean, but to keep our community clean. Because we don't realize that the people who are sitting on the park benches and in the public parks, our children are playing there. On the bus rails or, you know, everything that they touch or, where their spaces, that we are all in the same community. And so God has shown me some different other organizations who are doing some phenomenal work with health and hygiene items, recycling soap. I'm looking to do that very soon. I definitely want to go.
Do that?
Oh yeah, you could take the things that you discard. I promise you, you will be surprised at what you.
Are we talking about that soap? The soap shards?
You know, Grandmama used to have you put it in a jar and melt it down and cream it up. You could take the solid bars and clean it, shred it, and clean it again and make it into new bars. And so I'm looking to do that in the near future to make sure.
That's recycling.
That sounds like chemistry. That's what it sounds like.
It's gonna be a lot of work, but I'm up for it. So and so we're talking about not just in the city of Atlanta. We're not just talking about surrounding states. We're talking about a global project because this affects people in other countries. And so that goes back to our hygiene is very, very important. Mm. So it goes to if I don't brush my teeth, it can lead to other illnesses in my body. When people start losing their teeth. So that's what the love bag is. That's what we're putting together. And so we just did cross country. We drove from Atlanta to California.
Yes, I saw. Congrats. Wow. I saw that.
Thank you. Thank you. We stopped in every state along the way. We dispersed 11,000 hygiene kits.
Oh, my
Wait, so what did y'all drive?
Drove a Ford, if you're listening.
Look, shout out your sponsors by all means.
We drove a Suburban. We sat down together at the table and we put this idea together, what it would look like. We put a budget together. We raised the funds to do it. And I had two awesome people. Shout out to Christopher and Joe, if you're listening, because they were brave enough to go with me.
I'm
one of those that when God speaks to me at 3:30 in the morning, I come back and tell the team, and they're like, Erica, you're crazy. So our next goal, I would like to finish the mission off this year, which God had given me in January to do 100,000 kits. Mm. So we're going to go to New York. The cat is out the bag. I was going to announce it next week.
Look, I did not push her. I told her whatever she wants to talk about, she can talk about.
But we're going to drive to New York in October. And we're going to just start. We're going to start. Well, this time, instead of going one way, we're going to drive to New York and back. So we're going to go up North Carolina, Virginia, to New York, D.C., New York, and then we're going to come on the other side to Ohio and all the way Tennessee and make it.
What are y'all going to drive? Same thing?
I don't know. Ford, if you listen, I like that Suburban, but we're going to take more team members this time, so we can probably take a van. And so and our goal this time is 20,000 hygiene kits.
Okay.
Do you bring the kits with you, or do you produce them at the locations that you get, in the town once you get there?
What we did, the last trip was I was begging. I was pleading and begging, and Amazon, we found that we could definitely buy in bulk. Okay. So when people financially contributed to you first, we were able to buy toothbrushes and toothpaste and stuff in bulk.
Y'all can do that from Sam's Club?
Well, it's a little cheaper. I'm sorry. It's a little cheaper. Well, so we were able to do what I call a simple bag. Now, there are different bags that we like to do. There are bags where we would like to do hand sanitizers and so on and so forth. But we were able to just do a washcloth, soap, travel size toothpaste, and a toothbrush. That was like just a general kit. But what we were able to do also was to go into each shelter to assess and see what they were doing differently than Atlanta. Mm. Because the last administrator, they closed the local shelter down here in Atlanta, which housed about almost 400 to 500 people, homeless people.
Let's segue.
Okay.
What does the homeless community look like in Atlanta? Like shelters, stuff like that. Is there enough? Is there not enough? What does it look like? Because I don't know.
Well, the homeless community looks totally different. And again, this goes with the journey. Me sleeping in my office, I was homeless. People who are on vouchers are still technically homeless. People live in shelters. They're homeless. There's the working poor who live in shelters, who work at MARTA, McDonald's. They live in shelters for different reasons. I mean, look at the people who lost their homes in California with the fire. Let's just say California. You lose your home, you don't have the proper insurance. Mm. Red Cross put you up in a hotel for a couple of weeks, and where are you? You got to figure it out. I've gotten phone calls from people that I met on the street who were at Salvation Army. People don't realize you have to pay to stay in some of the shelters in Atlanta.
Really?
Yes. Ooh, I didn't know that. So every time you see somebody begging, there again, through my own journey, I realized everything wasn't just about what we were taught or told, people are actually out here trying to get $16 or $9 so they can go and lay their head down in someone's facility, take a hot shower, get a meal, and be safe. And that's not, that's a whole different component about being safe out on the streets. But so yeah, I mean, that's what home, we talk about our youth that go to school. We deal with counselors who identify children who have are experiencing homelessness. We have mothers who decide if I'm going to go in this shelter and I have two gender, two kids, different genders, and my 16-year-old son has to sleep over in the next barracks with men that I don't know. So I choose to do what? I choose to just stay in my car. So it definitely looks different. Even in California, our homeless community, there are a lot of RVs that are just sitting on the side of the road, right? And you'll be surprised at how many people live in those RVs in their cars. So I the homeless, we're talking about a crisis, which is getting, if we don't do something about it, we're going to have an epidemic. We're going to have an epidemic.
So let's talk about the youth. So what does it look like for homeless youth? Because I know there's, for terms, there's regular heterosexual youth, and then there's homosexual youth,
right,
which I think from I've heard is a little different.
Right.
So what does that look like? Like, what is that looking like for our youth?
Okay. Well, let's start with there are local homeless shelters for youth.
Just youth?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. And let's say that they max out at a certain age. So they are, they may have a youth shelter, let's say anywhere from 11 to maybe 19 or 20. So if you're 21 and you don't have, or you're not in another program, then you could typically find yourself in another homeless shelter. There are LGBTQ youth shelters. There's one lost and found that I know of directly. It is not a housing facility. It is only a facility where children can come in off the streets, no questions asked. They can take a shower. They can get a meal. They can get clean clothing. But the thing about the state, the political arena behind that, they're not actually awarded to the state. So I can't just take a youth and bring them into this shelter and make them, give them a place to stay. So there's a lot of the in-between that a lot of people don't know because of the politics that goes with it. And then you have your foster care system. There are a lot of...
Let's hold on. All right, so we're going to take our last break, and when we come back, we're going to get more involved with Erica and you first. So stick around the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice.
Can't believe that I'm home all alone. Doesn't stop me from wanting to see you. Why the hell won't you pick up the phone? Hello? Don't know which way is up anymore. No excuses and nothing to cling to. Oh, you're shaking me right to the core. Just wanna let you know I won't let this one go. You got me down, but I ain't out. Think you got me good, love me like something would. I may be down, but I'll turn around. All my friends that I told you so. You
All right, everybody, we are back with this week's edition of the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice, and correspondent Chris White, and our very special guest, Mrs. Erica Wright from You First. So when we left, we were talking about youth and the distinctions and how that goes, because their separation and this whole battle with homelessness is a little different. Mm-hmm. So continue where you were talking about.
We were talking about foster care. So there are a couple of shelters that we actually serve to, eight at Morris, one is at Conyers, and they house girls and boys. And so when you look at a community like that, that maybe house about 300 or 400 kids, we're talking about a whole different
dynamic.
Right, exactly.
And we're talking about all different races. We're not just talking about when I talk about homelessness, it has nothing to do with color. It has nothing to do with your sexual orientation. It has nothing to do with your religion background. It is just a circumstance that has happened to you. So if there are broken homes where children are in foster care, if there's the gay community where children can't feel comfortable at home, or they had a disagreement, the parents doesn't agree with their lifestyle, and they just need somewhere to go for just a couple of hours to just kind of vent and be them authentic selves, then there are places like that. But I will say, from driving cross country, from visiting different shelters in the city of Atlanta, where we're is our base, I think we can do more. Well, I know we can do more.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that there are not shelters that have adequate facilities or washing of clothes and, you know, making sure people can come in and clean up. But I think that we can do a little bit better. And I'm just stating this because we have a gazillion dollar dome.
Okay.
Yes.
And so, and I do believe that the new administration will definitely look at the homeless situation and do a little bit more. But right now, You First is at a standstill about going out into the community, because I believe in being in compliance with the law. So that's why we choose not to go out anymore to service on the streets.
There's that, a law?
Oh, yes.
From
the last administrator, they put a law in place where you can no longer feed or service the homeless community without having a permit. And if I'm not mistaken, I could be wrong, I think the permit is around $200-$300.
Really?
And so, or maybe higher. But I would rather take that resource and put into the resources of what we need. And so, again, we have identified through the different shelters of what their needs are, and then we service them once a month. So every second Saturday, we're usually at the Peter Street Storage, but you know, I'm praying that God's going to bless us with a facility. But we've been at the rec center for the last 2 months. The Adamsville Rec Center will be there July the 14th from 11 to 2. We do two things there. We are asking for donations to put in the bags, but we also have enough inventory to make at least 1,000 bags a month.
Mm.
And so what we do is we identify maybe a couple of weeks prior, what is your need? Gateway. They may have 300 beds. They may only need 200 bags. Lost and Found, our youth homeless LGBT youth kids may only need 50 bags. We may donate 100. And so, and that's what we're doing in the community right now. And not only that, I just got someone to ask about Cobb County. And so I don't want us to just think Atlanta when we talk about cities. We're talking about small communities. We're talking about the, you know, Cobb County, DeKalb County, because what has happened is the homeless now are being pushed out. So they are traveling to other places.
Other states or other cities?
Other cities, little towns. And, you know, I'll even go out there and say, as far as some things that I know, that they will put homeless people on a bus and move them.
I heard that, that when we had DragaCon or one of those, maybe it was Olympics, that they cleared them off the streets and just kind of...
But it's not just in Atlanta.
Got rid of them.
It's an eyesore for what a city is trying to represent. And so, but being mindful, if that's their practice, that's their practice. Morals, I don't agree with it. But I was on a plane with a lady going to California, and she was going to Hawaii. And she told me, you would be amazed at how many homeless people are in Hawaii, because they put them on a plane and take them to Hawaii. How are you going to get back?
Oh, my God. Are you serious?
How are you going to get back? So there are a lot of things that's going on in the homeless community that I think that a lot of people don't know. We're trying to bring it to the forefront, and we're trying to be that beacon of light out there to say, hey, we want to do our part to be a part of the solution, not the part of the problem. And so we do have other entities. You know, don't get me wrong. I'm a fan of United Way and Goodwill. I think they're all doing awesome work. But I think there are some grassroots organizations like You First and CIA. I can go on and name a couple of people that I know personally who are out on the ground, who are feeding people every week, who are trying to make sure that the people who are under the bridges, places that people would not go or don't want to go or don't want to see, that they live. And it's not just because, oh, they're lazy, they want to be there. We have people who have mental illness. Mm-hmm. There's a guy right on the corner where I live. I'm still trying to figure out how I can get him help because he is mentally disturbed and he sleeps up under the bridge. But that's what he knows. And so how do we go to these individuals and just take them from what they know? And so and those are different components, again, that we're learning. We're trying to be a part of other solutions. There are some churches that are doing great work. There are churches that go out in the middle.
In Cobb, I think Must Ministries.
Yeah, they go out in the middle of the night. They make sure that they have what they need. And then they try to get them off the street. But I do think that Atlanta, from some things that I've seen in Dallas and New Mexico, even in Dallas alone, we visited about 3 shelters. 2, we dispersed 1,000 bags to 1 shelter alone because they housed 1,000 people in one day to come in to take a shower. No questions asked.
Wow.
So can you imagine that was just 3 that we visited? How many people are we really talking about who are homeless?
Jesus. And that was in Texas?
That was in Dallas. We went to El Paso, New Mexico, Arizona, California.
Okay, well, you can say you have seen
Louisiana. I mean, Mississippi, Alabama. We've been there.
What's the worst scenario you've seen with all that traveling? Like, you don't have to call the state, but what was the worst scenario you've seen?
I'll speak in my experience of my 3 years. My worst is always the children.
Oh.
Even when we served at Cortland and Pine, where the people would come to the table to see a lady with multiple children. Staying in a facility that was just not conducive for children to be in, an environment. Because even in a shelter, you have people who have mental illness. And so children are witnessing things that they can't even fathom. And so what's happening is you have to look at it like this. When they talk about a society that's going to keep growing, when, you know, we had the projects and, if you grow up on the projects, you know, your kid's going to be in the project. Well, if you're homeless 9 times out of 10, if the problem is not rectified, your child is homeless and will adapt to that. And then you have a whole different generation of the same population just keep spearing over and over and over. And then also we were talking about a couple of weeks ago, the education is another factor in which we don't always consider, you know, resumes, getting a job. I was just at a summit the other day, and what's her name? She's running for mayor.
Stacey Abrams,
and she was talking about people who have been incarcerated, and once they're out, that's with you. It's a stigma. Mm. Nobody wants to hire you, even if you know you just made a stupid mistake. It's on your record. So, okay, so what does that do? That gives you a $7 job an hour. You know, I'm only making $7 and my rent is this, and I'm trying to figure out which one I'm going to do. And so then I go doing something else stupid, and I find I'm back in incarcerated again, and now I got 2 strikes, so nobody really want to hire me. And so, you know, it's just one of those things that we really have to start looking at a big spectrum of what does homelessness really look like. Because when you asked me that in the beginning, I can tell you it looks like a man who's holding a sign. It looks like a guy who's laying out in the middle of the park on a 12 o'clock in the daytime. But that's not really what it is. It is really our working poor. It is really those people who are just trying to make it, and sometimes not through fault of their own. I remember... Even me being kind of judgmental. Well, won't they just go get a job? Why don't you just go get a job? I think it's instinctive. Why are you out in it? It's 12 o'clock on a Monday. Why are you sleeping in the park? Until I found myself, and Lord and my mom, watch you have a fit. I found myself, I missed my train in L.A. to go to Ontario. And the train, Mission Union Station didn't open till like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And I caught an Uber from LAX to the train station only to find out that they weren't open.
Ew.
So I sat there for about 2 hours. But it was nothing but God to show me the mobility of the homeless walking around with carts, women, men. And you know why? Can you imagine what go on in the middle of the night when nobody is policing in a community? Violence, rape, drug addicts, on and on and on and on and on. And so what I had an opportunity to see was the women who were just walking around trying to stay up.
Oh, wow.
Trying to stay up so no one would mess with them. Mm. So then come back through Union Station 2 days later to get ready to come home at 12 o'clock, and they're laying in the park. You know why? Because I can be safe to lay in this park right now. No one would mess with me. No one would bother my belongings. Mm. One of the things we saw on our way to California were shelters that house lockers. So you could put your things. In California, a guy said, he said, look up, Erica, look in the trees. People would leave their book bags in the trees so they could go and do their day-to-day responsibilities, go look for a job. Or, you know, there were shelters that had clothing closet where, you know, you can go in and get an interview outfit. A suit, a tie. Women can go and get a dress or something that they needed or whatever it was that they wanted to wear. And so these are, like I say, so many different variables to things that we're witnessing. And so what we want to do is we want to just keep doing the work. We want to come back. We're going to make a documentary of it. And we hope to sit down before the city and say, hey, this is what they're doing, west, east, wherever. And I think that Atlanta could be a good place to have a model or a mold. And we could be that next city to do it. Why not?
Yeah, the power of one gets a lot of movement started. So it's don't take a group. Don't take a consensus.
No.
I don't even know what to say. It is rare that I am speechless. And right now, because I'm starting to see what you're saying. Because there are employees that we've had at my part-time job, and I didn't get it. Mm-hmm. And I had one lady that came through, and she's like, well, yeah, you know, me and my kids are living in a hotel. And I'm like, what?
Right.
She was like, yeah, we're living in a hotel. I'm like, wait a minute, those things are like $300 or $400 a week.
Yeah.
She was like, yeah, and you know, it's just, but it's where we have to be. And I'm like, how can you afford $300 or $400 a week with three kids? Like, how are you, because I know we don't pay you that much.
Yeah, when so you have a bad credit score, how do you get housing? When you have this and you don't have enough money for your down payment, how do you get housing?
Wow.
And that's what's going on in L.A. L.A. don't really have, I mean, if you can afford a house.
My uncle lives in L.A., so look, I was there, but I was in Encino, like the expensive part, so I was like, oh, this is bomb.
It's very expensive. And even in Atlanta, you know, the more and more we grow as the city is growing, the prices are going up. Mm-hmm. And if, like I said, and it goes back to education, it goes back to a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and those people that fall into that gap, I have fallen into that gap. And so I am grateful because I think God has, you know, designated me to be a part of
the martyr. You get to be the martyr.
And I didn't say I chose to be, but I am. But again, I was just telling you offline. I mean, this is gratifying to me because I've learned so much. I've met so many people along the way. And the other part of that is we were talking so much about the social media and how diversity is going on around us. But I will say this, in the midst of all of that, there are still people who care. There are still people who have a heart. There are still people who believe in humanity. And I am grateful for the team, you first team, because I'm telling you, I have some amazing people who have just watched like you and said, Erica, I want to be a part. What do you need to do? Well, just come on. And even with me, we're still growing. There are a lot of things that I don't
know. Touching hearts, touching lives.
I don't know, but we're going to figure it out together.
All right, so you have 2 minutes.
Okay.
Tell us how to get in touch with you.
All right.
Tell us what you need.
Oh, well, let me tell you what I need. We need
some
money.
You got 2 minutes.
All right. You can follow us. The easiest way is to go to our website. It's Project You First, just the word project, the letter U, the word first.org. My number directly is 404-360-6685. We are on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, U-First, the word first. Please follow us, check like, and what do we need? Money.
Okay, but those that can't give money.
We have a GoFundMe, JR4JP8. But if you would like to just come out and volunteer, we always need extra hands, extra hearts. Reach out to us. We always need washcloths, toothbrush, toothpaste, all of those simple necessities, items that we collect.
All right, people. So there, she has spent the whole day with us. And the funniest thing is when she came in, she was like, well, you know, I probably won't say a lot, but you know, I'll be there. You know, I'll try.
She's a great co-host now.
Between you two, I didn't even have to talk today. Awesome. So I'm like, this is amazing. I didn't even have to talk between you two. So we definitely want to thank you for coming. Well, this will not be your last time because we family now. So we're going to be doing things. We're going to definitely work with her.
Come and help too.
You know, have a conversation with Miss, our lovely owner, Miss Trish.
Right.
We get some things going. And the bullpen back there with the interns, the bullpen. So we can get all that involved. So, Chris, your final words. You have a minute.
Thank you, Ricardo. Always a good segue. I want to say this has been an eye-opener because we have an Earth Angel in our presence here. Aww. Because when you're doing things and you're altruistic and you're doing things for others before yourself, and as I was hearing through your backstory, you were taken through these trials so you personally understand and empathize and can have a visualized future for the people that you're having an impact and you're making a vision and mission plan for them based on you personally experiencing it. And it's not just some distance feelings. You have personal feelings and you can empathize and try to create.
I said one minute.
So I just make sure you go to the website. Is it
projectyoufirst.org?
Project You First. And look at this as a local offering. And people are doing things for missions across the country. Mm-hmm. Do something in your local community also. Then do something as far as a mission.
That's right.
Okay. Again, Chris does not know what time is. And I'm going to teach him yet about time and getting in what you need to get in a lot of time. That's part of his growth and development here on the Leadership Blend.
Thank you.
Again, I just want to say to you, I have watched you for a year, and what the work you do is beyond amazing. Like I said, I had a nonprofit. I couldn't do it. The begging
hard.
For money and just it was too much for me. I was like, I'd rather just make money and funnel it back. It's just too much.
Well,
so to see that you do it every day, it's
no
amazing.
Grants.
Look, she does it every day. It's amazing. And look, if without people like you, this world would cave.
Oh,
so I thank you for the work that you do. I have every intention of working with you.
Thank you.
And I'm just looking forward to what you're going to do because you're just amazing. And,
thank you.
You know, I love. I have to have a circle full of amazing people.
Oh, I love.
So
it.
I have to add you to my circle of
please,
amazing people
please.
So that we can get some great things done.
Thank
all
you.
Right, you guys, thank you for tuning in. We will
thank
see you
me.
Next week, same time, same place, on the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice. Have a great week.
Awesome.